So good morning. It's a pleasure to join you this morning. And thank you, Carl, for a very stimulating presentation about how we are a creature of extremes, whereas many other species, if not most other species, are creatures of enough, and how they are able to moderate themselves, whereas we somehow need to construct reasons and rationales and justifications to perceive ourselves and our actions, our institutions, our relationships, and our economies in the extreme ways that we have developed them thus far. And so one of the arenas that I look at are the stories that we use to tell ourselves about ourselves to justify our extremism. And perhaps that's what we're going to be looking at here today, are some of those stories. And the focus, as Lori said at the beginning, we're going to be talking about a broad range of issues, and we're also going to be diving deep. And I think this one might be a diving deep presentation. We're going to be looking at what is companionship. And many of us think that companionship has sort of a platonic kind of way of engaging and stimulating dialogue with somebody. And that's what you do with a companion. Whereas for others of us, we break it down to its etymological roots. It's companion with bread. That's what you do with companions, and that's what you do in a company, is you break bread with them. Others of us think that a companion is somebody that you play with in a variety of different ways. And we saw pictures in the previous presentation about playful interactions. Some of us think that companions share some sort of morphology. Some of us think that companions actually have a desire for, to, with, about that other creature. And some of us actually want to procreate or seek ways to procreate with our companions. And we do that by copulating with them. And we also do it by protecting them. Perhaps protecting the offspring from that copulation, or protecting our partner from all of the others who might copulate with our partner. If these are some of the features that we would throw into this notion of companionship, it's not a new notion. It's been one that's been wrestled with from civilizations from as long as we have recorded history. And one of the oldest stories that we have available to us is, of course, the famous story of Gilgamesh, the ancient king of Uruk, about 2500 BCE. And in this story, Gilgamesh is an awesome dude. He's one-third human, two-thirds deity. And he is described as a really powerful, beautiful, smart, wise, athletic soldier kind of governor. But then the gods compel Aruru to create for him a Zikaru. They said to Aruru, create for Gilgamesh a Zikaru, something that would be an equal, a reasonable response to Gilgamesh. And so she created Enkidu. Enkidu was this wild creature, hairy from head to foot, and he cavorted with wild beasts. He protected them from all of the traps of human civilization. He drank water with them at the water well, stooping down and jostling with them, and he kept them away from all of the trappers' traps. And finally, the trappers went to Gilgamesh to figure out how to get him, to stop him from terrorizing them. And so Gilgamesh said, of course, it being an anthropocentric, androcentric text, he says, get a prostitute. So they bring a prostitute. She exposes herself. Enkidu is intrigued. And it is through her guiles that he is eventually tamed and civilized. Of course, you know the rest of the story. Enkidu, they go off. Gilgamesh wrestles with Enkidu. They become best friends, best buddies, and they venture off to go conquer the world. Unfortunately, Enkidu gets diseased. He dies, and Gilgamesh is distraught. And he spends the rest of the books trying to figure out how to avenge his beloved's death and to make sense of the loss of this beloved partner of his. Now, This ancient text of a companionship between species is not the only old text that we have that wrestles with this. Many of us are more familiar with this particular story, which is found in the book of Genesis in the Bible, which has framed and undergirded most of Western civilization since it was constructed. And most of us think that this is a fairly accurate depiction. You know, you might change the skin color depending on what culture you're from, but we understand that Adam and Eve were found in the Garden of Eden and they were beguiled by this wily creature called the snake. I beg to differ, and this is where we're going to dive deep into this very famous story that has, for thousands of years, shaped how we think about what it means to relate and what it means to relate with or against animals. So we should recognize that the very problem that that is at hand here in the book of Genesis is not a human problem. The human problem of loneliness, of existential loneliness, was not a problem for the primordial Adam. It was God, hence that part. It is God who says, it is not good for man to be alone. I'll make a fitting ezer kenegdo, a fitting helpmate for him. So what do we notice in this particular biblical statement? Already, we recognize that God recognizes that God has failed. God created Eden, the beautiful bucolic garden. God created human being and put him into that garden. And all of a sudden, God did not foresee this problem. So God is acknowledging divine failure. But what's curious here is that God does not have a preconceived notion about what is an ezer kenegdo. God is deferring to the human to discern what is this appropriate helpmate. Now, what happens next? So God goes back into the divine workshop and creates all these amazing array of creatures and trots them before this primordial human being to see what this man will call it, and that will be its name. And so the man gives the names to all the cattle and the birds of the sky, to all the wild beasts, but for Adam, no fitting helpmate was found. All of the creatures were created precisely to fill this role of being an ezer kenegdo, a helpmate for this primordial human being. That was God's initial impulse, is for there to be a trans-specific companion for this primordial human being. Failure number two for that great God up in the sky. So we now know the rest of the story. So God becomes the anesthesiologist, putting the man to sleep. God takes out the rib. You break open a rib. What do you find inside? Bone marrow. What's inside bone marrow? Stem cells. Stem cells are then you can put back on a rib, and you can create a scaffold and create a whole new organ, if not organism altogether. God then also sews up the man. Somewhere it says, God sews up the man, so God is also the earliest plastic surgeon, and brings this new creature to the man, and he says, wow, this is awesome. He takes her. Now, what's interesting is this whole long conversation about the search for an ezer kenegdo is when you look in the Torah scrolls, there is no break whatsoever between chapter 2, the creation of all the animals and the creation of women, and chapter 3, where we begin that conversation with the serpent. There is no break here. There's no period, there's no gap, there's no paragraph. It is all one conversation in the Torah scroll. What you know as chapter 3 and the verses, that's a much later innovation in biblical scholarship. And what's also interesting is that the text identifies this word pair. And this is what it says. The two of them, meaning the two human beings, were erumim, the man and his wife, and they felt no shame. The nachash, the serpent, was the most erum of all the wild beasts that the Lord God had made. And then we continue into the now famous story. The Nahash speaks to the woman, did God really say you shouldn't eat of the tree of the good, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So what's interesting here is that both creatures, the human beings and the Nahash, share in this quality of arumness. What is arumness? Well, it's defined in two different ways. It either means naked or it can mean shrewd, cunning, guiling, creative, scheming. And this is usually how it's paired when you look at most English translations of the Bible, is that the Nahash, when the Nahash is described as Arum, it is described as being shrewd or cunning of all the beasts, whereas the human beings, their Arum is considered to be naked. Why? Why can't we recognize that these two species share in this same quality, and why do we divide them up so dramatically as we do? It might very well be that they share each other's features. So let's play that out. So the Nahash is now speaking with the woman. Huh, that's interesting. Isn't that what companions do? They talk with each other? According to the great Jewish historian Philo of Alexandria in the first century CE, he said that snakes could speak with a human's voice. He was agreed by Flavius Josephus, also an ancient historian, that all living things, all creatures, spoke with the same language, whereas Rabbi Eliezer in the 11th century, he said that the Nahash actually knew Hebrew, the Nahash could speak with Adam and Eve, whereas all the other creatures had their own distinctive languages. Sonar, echolocation, barking, meowing, whatever you want to call it. But they're communicating. Maybe not in the language that we can comprehend. Maybe that's the limitations of our small brains. But at least, according to the later readers, they saw in this biblical text, of course we can talk with other species because those other species, and this one in particular, shares in human language. What about eating? The curse that is found in chapter 3 that is meted out to the serpent, the Nahash, the woman, and to the man after their happenstance of consumption from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. If the curses are to mean anything, if we are to take the Bible seriously, which I encourage you to do every now and then, if the curses are to mean anything, it must have ontological significance in order for them to have curse-like capacity or features. So if the curse is, the dirt shall you eat in all the days of your life, it must have meant that before that time, the Nahash ate not dirt. So what did the Nahash eat? And it turns out that at least according to the rabbinic tradition, which has been commenting for thousands of years upon the older biblical tradition, they understand that the Nahash came and saw Adam, who was having a barbecue made for him, a barbecue of roasting meat and cooling wine by the ministering angels. And the Nahash became envious of him. In other words, the Nahash desired to eat the beautiful things, the yummy things that this human being was about to enjoy. Now, we could take umbrage with this notion because we all know that in the Edenic world, they had a vegan or vegetarian frugivore kind of diet. But let's bracket that out and just notice that the Nahash wanted to eat what the human being was wanting to eat. Josephus agreed that the Nahash lived with Adam and his wife. And we all know that when animals live with human beings, they are often fed the same fare that the human beings are eating. Martin Luther chimes in on this, and he says that the Nahash was the most beautiful creature of all the beasts and delightful to man, such as little goats, lambs, and kittens. In other words, they were not just serving and nearby humankind, they were actually domesticated creatures. They were in the home. And if they're in the home, they're going to be eating what human beings are eating. So the Nahash, before it was cursed to eat dirt,
was eating what you and I would have eaten, or at least what the primordial human being would have eaten. Now, what about the second part of the curse? I will put animosity or enmity between you and the woman, between your offspring and hers. Well, if that is supposed to have any significance, it must have meant that beforehand they were BFFs. And indeed, that's what we get, this picture from Yehuda Berlin in the 19th century. He says that when Eve slept, the Nahash would suckle her milk without injuring her. Only when she awoke would she flee the Nahash, and the Nahash would flee as if it were an enemy to her, like a playful kind of activity. The biblical idiom of God putting animosity between them could only come after the fact that she loved it, and it typically stayed by her side, like that dog running after you at the beach. And only then was the Nahash made her enemy. Again, what this is suggesting is that hidden within the biblical text was that there was a close relationship between the Nahash and Eve before the stuff hit the fan. So what about the other part of the curse? On your belly you shall crawl. Well, how did the snake move before the curse? Well, thankfully, we have some ideas about this. The Nahash used to have legs before they were cut off. And it was the ministering angels who cut those legs off, says another source. And another source said that, in fact, the Nahash stood and touched the trees with hands and made its fruit fall by shaking the tree. So as early as 1,000 years ago, we have a Nahash being visually depicted with four legs, wings. And it was only around the 12th century that we now have the Nahash no longer being just a serpent, but a serpent with a human face, and not just any human face, but a virgin maiden's face. So this is one of the earlier depictions of a Nahash, now with arms instead of legs. But this Nahash over here has no arms, but plenty of a leg. And these Nahashim have the I don't know what that is. But obviously that Nahash needs to have more coffee. But there's something going on in the Renaissance art world where they felt compelled to depict this Nahash not as a serpent, but as a creature whose morphology has a human face and human appendages. Maybe with some horns, maybe with some pointed ears. Reaching down. But it's a familiar trope or visual trope that we see going on in the medieval period. Oh, by the way, trigger warning, there's nudity. Sorry, I should have said that. Now, if the Nahash is going to morph and look like human beings, could it not be that also the human beings could share some morphology with the Nahash? And we see this etymologically when we look at Eve's Hebrew name. Her name is Chava, and when it is translated to Aramaic, it is Chia, and Chia is also a word that means serpent. Huh. Her name means serpent. And this is captured in the ancient text, a non-canonical Christian text, the Book of the Cave of Treasures, where it says that when Eve turned around towards him, now it's saying Lucifer has come down to embody this or taken over the body of the Nahash. When Eve turned around towards him, she saw her own form reflected in him, and she talked to him, and Satan led her astray with his lying words because the nature of woman is soft and yielding. Again, the androcentrism, the misogyny is already evident in these texts, but it is also now captured in some art where the Nahash looks hardly different from Eve herself. They share their morphology. We see ourselves in the Nachash, just as the Nachash sees us. And perhaps the most famous depiction of the Nachash, is Michelangelo's Sistine Chapel. Notice that the Nachash has a human form, human appendages, even mammary glands. The Nachash looks like Eve. And so, of course, because of the similarity, there would be familiarity then, and Eve would be readily willing to engage in a conversation with this creature. Lucas Cranach, in the 16th century, had a fascination with this biblical story, and he spent years painting and repainting Adam and Eve. And we should note, and the Nachash, he's created probably 36 different settings of this, of these three. And here, at least, when he talks about the garden, or paints about the Garden of Eden, we again can see that the Nachash is not just a snake, but a creature with a human form and very female-oriented figure. Here's another depiction where he talks about not the beginning of times, but the end of times, the last judgment. And down here, let's take a look. Again, the Nachash is very feminine in form. Now it gets a little weirder. And perhaps the most weird of all, Hugo van der Goes, this particular creature has webbed feet. So the Nachash is now quite a problematic creature in the narrative that has been bequeathed to us for thousands of years. The biblical language describes the Nachash in male terms. Hebrew has only female and male terminology. It doesn't have neuter. The visual depiction that has been passed down to us, however, for the last several thousands of years, is that the Nachash is female. So which is it? Is the Nachash one or the other, or perhaps something else? I'm getting confused. I don't know about you. So let's return back. We now know after the Garden of Eden, they've been expelled. The text continues the story of Adam and Eve. We hear nothing more about the Nachash. The Nachash disappears from the biblical narrative. And the story picks up with the man, Adam, knew his wife, and they bore Cain, the first child. Well, according to rabbinic tradition, this is Rashi in the 11th century France, the man had known, prior to the story about the Nachash, before he had sinned and was driven out of the evening, he had known his wife. They had had sex in the garden. In fact, it was not just sex for sex purposes, it was procreative sex. And that the pregnancy and the birth of Cain also preceded the incident of the Nachash. So there was sex going on in that Edenic bucolic garden, at least conspecific sex, according to Rashi. But is that all? We should note that that sex was under the gaze of the Nachash, because ophidians do not blink. Sorry, I need to change these visuals here. But the Nachash was watching everything. The Nachash was nearby and watching. So the Nachash watched them have their sex, and it conceived a passion for Eve. Or we now know that it watched them have sex, and it desired her. So these rabbinic texts are imputing a motivation into the Nachash, which now makes sense why the Nachash gets Eve in trouble in the first place. Because perhaps the Nachash wanted to be the partner, the companion to Adam in Eve's stead. But perhaps the Nachash didn't want to only desire her. Perhaps the Nachash was more ambiguous. Because the Nachash observed them having sexual relations, it desired both of them. And he was envious of their living happily together. Perhaps the Nachash was polyamorous. So getting back to that animosity, another rabbinic tradition says that God placed animosity between the Nachash and the woman because the Nachash had said, I will kill Adam and marry Eve. In other words, the Nachash didn't want to have an open relationship. The Nachash wanted to have an exclusive relationship with Adam, with Eve. So now the Nachash is being portrayed as male. And here are some visual depictions of the Nachash in male form. And down here, you can't see it, but Cabanel draws a very devilishly looking male serpent escaping. And this is perhaps the most evocative. Yes, it's talking about Job and Olympia, but you can see the snake-like character of it. So we have a problem here. Is the Nachash male, female, or something else? It is unclear. So did they have sex? The Nachash desires to have at least some ownership or intimacy with Eve, perhaps with both Adam and Eve. Was there sex? Well, what does Zotapa'am mean when Adam says, finally, this one, at last, is bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh? Does Zotapa'am, this one, mean this woman or this time? Or something else? What does it mean? It's unclear. But we do know that it's in reference to, finally, Adam is satisfied that he has now found an Ezer Knegdo, which means that perhaps Adam had had sexual intercourse with every beast and animal, but he found no satisfaction until he had cohabited with Eve. This is ensconced in the Babylonian Talmud, the most authoritative text in the rabbinic tradition, and it's repeated by Rashi, the greatest commentary on the biblical material. He says that Zotapa'am teaches that Adam had sex with every animal, but he wasn't satisfied by them. And this is echoed later on in the text, again by Rashi and other commentators, that cattle and beasts and fowl did not consort with their own species. There was trans-Pacific sex going on in the antediluvian world before the flood. And again, that's also echoed in the Babylonian Talmud. And man had sex with all of them, and they all had sex with the man in the antediluvian world before the flood. There was trans-Pacific copulation. Now, was there procreation going on? Well, let's take a look at that poor man, Cain. It says that Cain was not just the child of the serpent, but the child of an adulterous relationship between Eve and the serpent. The serpent sired Cain in this textual tradition. And it's not the only one where she is the mother of Cain, obviously, but the serpent is the father of Cain. And it was Adam who came to her afterwards, and she conceived from Adam, Abel. So in other words, Eve is having procreative sex with two different creatures of two different species. And this is picked up in the mystical texts of the Zohar as well. That two beings had intercourse with Eve, and she conceived from both of them and bore two children. And what about protecting? When it says that she plucked from the fruit of the tree, and she took its fruit and ate, and then gave it to her husband, and he ate, that's what it says in the biblical Hebrew. According to the Septuagint, it doesn't say, and he ate, it says, and they ate. Who's the they there? Why should it say they? That would be redundant. And so, according to other rabbinic traditions, Rashi in particular, it means that she gave the fruit not just to her husband, Adam, but also to the Nachash and all of the other creatures. Why? So that she should not die and he survive and marry another. She is greedy, as you said before. She wants to keep him to herself. And this is found in some rabbinic
traditions.
So the Nahash and the humans are both Arum. But I would suggest they're also both shrewd. They're both naked. And at least this biblical material suggests that this story is not about so much some sort of sin as much as a meditation on what it means to be an Ezer Kenegdo, on what it means to be a partner. Because when we meditate on the features of companionship, we see that these features are found not only with conspecifics, members of our own species, and we can see these things operating among elephants with elephants and dogs with dogs and orcas with orcas, but we also see it happening across species as well, at least in these Judaic and Christian texts as well as imagery. So what is the significance of this sort of exploration, this deep dive into this foundational story? It could very well be that this is how we forge language itself. Some scholars have noted that it is in conversation with animals and about animals in Genesis chapter 2 that the first human words are recorded. Even the story of Gilgamesh itself is the first layer of human recorded language. Why is it that it's about trans-Pacific companionship? There's something about our relationship with other creatures that is the fount of human language, of discourse itself. Obviously, it's a meditation on identity, on what it means to be oneself in contradistinction to an other, and what value I have is relative to that identity, both to myself, to my companion, whether that companion is a conspecific or a transpecific, as well as a meditation on what it means to cohere with your companion. So, thank you very much.
Okay? Oh, there it is. Okay. Thank you, Laurie. And thank you, Jonathan, for a very interesting, very risque presentation. It's oftentimes forget that you're ordained, that you're an ordained minister. You've got a very dirty mind for a rabbi. So I was wondering, on that note, if we could actually begin with a brief autobiographical reflection. You present a very unorthodox reading of the biblical story of the Nahash, at least a reading that I would presume most of us in this room were not at all familiar with, and yet you derive this reading from some of the most authoritative texts in the tradition. So I was wondering if you could tell us a little about how you arrived at this reading, and I'm particularly interested, were you ever exposed to this kind of reading in your own religious upbringing? Is this also a very unorthodox reading from considering your background?
No. Like many of you, I was given standard interpretations of the biblical material, that this was a very anthropocentric text, very much concerned about the conditions of humankind as it is today, instead of some sort of meditation on what it could have been otherwise. And although I did receive, through my rabbinic training, the imperative to take biblical material seriously. The ancients who composed these stories and compiled them, redacted them, and then bequeathed them down the centuries, the millennia, down to us today, did so because they thought that they were important. And every single word, every single letter within the words was forged and captured and preserved because of its potentials for what it means and what it could mean. And so because of the importance that they valued to all of the features of these biblical materials, I have learned to take the biblical material at face value. What is it actually saying? Not what has my subsequent tradition taught me to see in the text. Don't read it eisegetically. Don't read into the text, but read it exegetically. Read out of the text. What is the text saying? And that's where I stopped using the word serpent to describe the Nachash, because we only describe the Nachash as a serpent after the curses, when it is no longer ambulating upright on legs, after it no longer is eating the dainties that human beings eat, that it is no longer in an intimate relationship with human beings. Those are the features of our relationship with serpents now, but that's not what that creature was before the curses. And so I don't call it a serpent when I'm studying it in Genesis chapter 2 and 3 before the curses. I call it the Nachash. I don't know what it looked like. Those are visual depictions of what the artists thought it was. And some of them might have been smoking something heavy. I don't know. But I have learned to take the biblical material seriously and take the rabbinic material that have been commenting on the biblical material for thousands of years also seriously. And what I see happening here, and this is perhaps another iteration of this project going forward, is that the thread of appreciating the Nachash as some sort of creature with whom meaningful companionship could be had is found throughout Jewish textual tradition, from the earliest chapters of the Bible to the 19th century at least, if not into the 20th century, that Jewish sages have been saying, of course, we can speak with them, we can play with them, we can eat with them, we can have meaningful interactions with them, we share morphology with them, we can even be intimate with them in a variety of different ways. And perhaps that's something that I want to capture in this, what you call a non-orthodox project. I'm just observing what is in our textual tradition and our visual tradition as well.
So I want to pick up on this concept of the companion, that term in itself, the English language term companion. So you frame your reading of the Nachash by the concept of the Ezer Kenegdo, which might be translated by fitting helpmate. That's the way you translate it. But you associate this term very closely with the concept or the term companion. Now, this term itself has recently gained a widespread currency, not only within popular discourse, but also within intellectual culture. So in our everyday language now, many people will refer to pets, what were previously known as pets, as companion animals. Companion animals is presumably a more respectful term. It establishes some kind of at least reciprocity, if not equality, between the previous owner and the previous pet. In intellectual culture, I'm thinking of the very important but controversial work of Donna Haraway. Donna Haraway thinks about the concept of a companion species and the way that no species evolves on its own, but rather that we're all involved in a process of coevolution. So you've picked up on a term, I presume, for some reason. So I was wondering if you might spell out some of the ethico-political implications of reading the story in terms of a trans-specific or a trans-species companionship. What are the stakes involved in thinking about the concept of companionship?
So this is a huge question. I will defer to the wisdom of the crowd about some of the ethical and political possibilities of such a reading. But I think that I'm also inspired by Leon Cass, who's also written about companionship and the importance of companionship in this particular story. He says that encountering the animal activates or creates the mutual and emotional powers that permit man to recognize and receive his fitting counterpart. That is, it is by encountering otherness that we can come to figure out what is sameness. That it is through the other that we learn to appreciate who we are. And we can only do that, only come to appreciate who we are by encountering others. And we've all heard the stories, I'm sure, about if you only know your own religious tradition, you don't know any. That you need to learn other religious traditions to really appreciate your own. If you don't only know your own culture, you really don't know any until you go out and explore and expose yourself to others. It is this encounter with otherness, with difference, that you can really come to appreciate and acknowledge and own
what is the same. So Donna Haraway's work on companionship, I think, offers us a provocative ways to think about it in techno jargon. She's definitely a likes using complicated words and ideas, but I think what she does capture very well in her manuscript, a manifesto for companion species, she talks about two different things, facts and fictions. Facts are actions that are completed, done, over, fixed, shown, performed, accomplished. Facts are past tense. That's what a fact is. Fiction, however, is, by contrast, actions that are fashioning, forming, inventing, feigning, and fainting. They are currently in process. That's what fiction means. And she pulls this into a conversation about companion animals to say that our relationships are fictions. They are a continual unfolding of possibilities. And that's what it means to be in relationship with others. It's a continual unfolding, and that through these unfoldings, these fictions, they become facts. And perhaps one of the ethical, theological, political outcomes of a project like this is to recognize that we have ossified what it means to be a companion into a fact, that there's only one species that we are permitted to have robust, deep, meaningful companionships with, and that is members of our own species. Whereas perhaps this ongoing millennia-old conversation is suggesting otherwise, that companionship is a fiction, an unfolding, a continual unfolding, that is perhaps best done when we continue to encounter other species in the wild and in proximity with us, and that by appreciating our unfolding relationships with them, we can better appreciate who we are in those relationships.
Mm-hmm. I'm particularly interested in this concept of the companion because it seems to open up some possibilities that even many animal studies scholars and animal rights activists themselves are still trying to work through. So there's that famous quote, isn't it George Bernard Shaw who says, animals are my friends and I don't eat my friends? I'm wondering whether companionship goes beyond friendship, because it's very difficult to think, at least for us today in this culture, it's very difficult for us to think about a snake as a friend. We think about dogs as friends, we think about rabbits as friends, other cute, cuddly creatures, but we certainly don't think about snakes, reptiles, insects, pests as our friends. And yet they are our companions. You want to speak about that a little bit? Is the snake a friend?
I don't have any in my
personal circle.
I should check, actually, on Facebook who's befriended me. But are snakes friends with human beings? They could be. And I think that's what Carl was indicating earlier, is that if we allow ourselves to be friends with them, they will be friends with us. Yes, there are some that are venomous and dangerous. Yes, stay away from those. But for the vast majority of other species, they are willing to be our companions. They're willing to be our friends. But we have prevented ourselves. We have deluded ourselves into thinking that we cannot and ought not to be friends with other species, specifically the ones that we've been trained to find disgusting. A snake inherently is not disgusting. We are trained to think of it as disgusting. And so perhaps one of our opportunities is to unlearn that which we have been trained about viewing other creatures. And so unpacking a story like this is perhaps a really important project for many of us. To unlearn our prejudices about other animals so that we can appreciate them in all of their glory.
The next question I wanted to ask you, you've already brought up a distinction that you made between exegesis and eisegesis, and this seems like a really very pointedly theoretical, if not academic, question, but I think it really has immense political implications. So the first small question before we move on to the larger question is the distinction itself. So exegesis is reading the text, reading what the text itself says, whereas eisegesis would be reading into the text or imposing your own interpretation, your own values, your own opinions into the text. Now, the first thing I want to ask, and it's a rather, again, a theoretical point, but is it possible to maintain a sharp or clear distinction between an exegesis and between an eisegesis?
That might be splitting hairs academically, and that conversation certainly would be well received in, say, the study of religion circles. Here, for our purposes, I think what matters is for us to understand how we read any text, whether it's a religious resource or whether it is a public policy or a newspaper, but we often come at it with intellectual baggage. And so, for example, just yesterday I was grading some graduate student papers, and they were reading, they declared that the serpent itself is Lucifer, is Satan. But that's not what the text says. The biblical text, if you read the text itself, that word Satan doesn't appear anywhere in it. That is a later Christian interpretation that has been imposed upon the text and then passed down through the centuries, and many of us have imbibed that tradition, and now we can only read it as if the serpent is Satan. And that, to me, is evidence of this intellectual baggage that muddles the way that we read and perceive a text. And I try to do it myself. I try to teach my students and community members to be aware when that is happening and to acknowledge and take ownership of the different ways that you are reading the text. They're both healthy ways to read the text. And I don't think any one should supersede the other, but to just be aware of it, that when we read words and studies, public policy, or newspaper accounts about current human-animal relationships, we often read into them what we want to see or what we've been trained to see, rather than reading out of them what they are actually trying to say. So that's what I try and do. So I try to encourage students to take note of when they are reading exegetically and when they're reading eisegetically.
So at this point, I'd like to bring up the problem of humanism. It seems to me that your main argument is that over the centuries, we've imposed a humanist or a human exceptionalist eisegetical reading on the biblical text. And I wanted to ask you, it's a very difficult question. So first, maybe if you could break down how that's happened over the centuries, and you've already begun to do this in your presentation. But I suppose I also want to ask the question about the relationship between humanism and theology or religious thought. Is religious thought inevitably, invariably tied to a notion of human exceptionalism? Is the belief that man was created in the image of God, is it not more kind of the other way around, where God, in fact, is supposed to, in the end, ensure humans of their own exceptional status in relation to the rest of the world, in relation to the rest of its existence?
I will have to disagree with that reduction of religion to a humanist enterprise, because as early as, say, 40,000 years ago in the Chauvet Cave in South France, and in other places where pre-written civilizations would go for thousands of years, their paintings depict humans in relationship with other species, in symbiotic relationships. There was no, there's no evidence from what we can see so far that those earlier civilizations understood human beings to be not just special and different, but different in kind and superior to those other species. Indeed, perhaps it was inverted, that those other species were revered. And Carl also pointed out that in the northwest of the United States, Native American tribes, through their totemic sculptures, often showed human beings in a subservient relationship to other creatures.
So not all religious traditions understand human speciality to be one, not just a difference in degree, but a difference in kind, and that that kind is superior to other creatures. It seems to be a residue of predominantly a Jewish-Christian worldview and particular interpretations of the biblical text. So the notion that human beings were given the power to not just be stewards of the natural world, but to subdue it, as it says in Genesis 1:28, when it says God created human beings in the image of God, and that you are now procreate pru or vu v'chiv shuha, to procreate ad nauseum or ad infinitum, and to subdue the earth. Giving priority to that biblical text has bequeathed to us what we now know as the humanist project. We think that we are special, but we had to construct that story in the first place to justify our desire to be exceptional. But not all religions, from what I have studied, mandate that we take on that narrative, that we are special not just by degree but in kind, that we are creatures of a completely different realm than all other creatures.
What I find particularly compelling about your presentation is the way it undermines the idea that even Western tradition or Western religious traditions in general are somehow humanist, whereas Eastern traditions are not. Sometimes we have this very romantic idea of Eastern religion as somehow being at peace with the world, or Aboriginal religion. So what's really interesting about your presentation is at the heart of the Western tradition, you're able to produce I suppose I wouldn't call it an anti-humanist, but a reading of companion species, a transpacific companionship.
I would agree with that, that it's a little bit more complicated. And then what's even more complicated is that the Genesis chapter 2 and 3 is actually old. What we now know as the creation number 2 is actually older than the creation story found in Genesis chapter 1. But whoever knew these different competing stories thought that the two should be put together and put together in this order. And so they gave the anthropocentric creation story, you should dominate the world, put that one first, whereas this more complicated intermingling kind of story, Genesis 2 and 3, they put it second. Now, it could have been otherwise. They could have jettisoned Genesis 2 and 3 altogether and left it out of the biblical corpus, and we wouldn't have this conversation today. But they kept it. In other words, there's something that's been bequeathed to us, but perhaps has not been really celebrated until this conference, thank you, Lori and Michael, that there is embedded in the Judaic Christian textual traditions this anti-humanist, more complicated relationship between humans and other species that is already there, has been there, continues to be there, and our challenge is to unearth it and celebrate it.
Let's before we open it up, I've got one last point for discussion I'd like to bring up. So you've brought up the two creation stories. So let's talk about the problem of sexual difference. Now, of course, the story of the Nahash is not only a story about trans-Pacific companionship, but it's also, in large part, a story about sexual difference. Now, many Christian feminist scholars have turned to the first creation story in the Bible, not the actually historically earlier one, but the one that's placed first. Many Christian feminists have turned to this creation story in order to stress the equality between men and women. So to roughly translate the text, as we all know, God created man in his image, male and female he created them. So the implication is that men and women were created at the same time, they were created equally. In this story, though, again, the second story, the older story, but the one that's placed second in Genesis, and your reading also tends to stress sexual difference. Now, not only, what's interesting about your particular reading is it stresses not only sexual difference between man and woman, between Adam and Eve, but also sexual difference between Adam, Eve, and the Nahash. So we're no longer dealing with a simple binary. We're dealing with at least three different positions here. So I'm wondering how sexual difference challenges the idea of the universal human subject, the supposedly universal non-gendered human subject that is central to humanism itself. And on the other hand, how sexual difference also connects us to non-human animals on the other. And not only non-human animals, but all sexuated beings, right? Including at least plants. So how does sexual difference, on the one hand, break up the notion of the gender-free, neutral, the gender-neutral human subject, and also the connections it establishes between human beings and non-human animals and all sexuated beings?
So I think I said that Hebrew has no neutral term. It has no it. It's either feminine or female. So it constructs the binary. And yet it has this story, this Nachash, which resists the binary. And so perhaps that's one way that it suggests that sexuality, gender, relations need not be confined to either or ways of thinking. I think that it's also important to recognize at the very beginning, I highlighted that God defers to the human being to discern who or what will be its fitting helpmate. God does not impose upon that primordial Adam what or who will that creature be. God defers to the individual to test, experiment, and discern. And finally say, Zotapam, finally, this one is the one who meets my peculiar needs. And if God is deferring to each human, at least, who or what will be an appropriate Ezer Kenegdo, who or what will be an appropriate fitting helpmate, who am I to mandate or circumscribe to others who or what will be their fitting helpmate? Who am I to construct laws to preclude other people from discerning who or what will be their appropriate partner, their appropriate companion? It suggests that whatever institutions I create, whatever rules and regulations me and my civilization create, if God allows the human being to be the agent of choice for what constitutes appropriate companionship, then all the more so should I, a mere human, provide and protect that kind of freedom to each and every to discern what is an appropriate idiosyncratic companion. And I think that allows us to resist the binarism, which is often apparent in humanist projects, especially when it comes to sexuality and gender.
I'm not sure whether you'd go this far. Might you call the Nahash a queer figure?
Delightfully so.
Perhaps on that note, we can open up to the floor for any questions. How do you want to do this? Should I?
Thanks very much. Just asking an etic question rather than an emic, so outside versus inside. So the Nakash in lots of biblical scholarship is seen as being culturally significant for the surrounding cultures within the milieu in which the story takes form and significance. And so if you see if that etic perspective is integrated into what you say here, can you see a difference there that could still make this an interesting discussion about the use of a culturally significant figure for competing religions? Within the cultural milieu in which the Hebrew community was living, and see that as also something that can actually both bring out interspecies relationships within a more religiously pluralist frame than what you've been given, because the Eddic perspective allows for religious pluralism to now enter this analysis. And so I'm just wondering if you have any thoughts about that.
So I'll answer part of that, and then I'll let Sean answer part of that. One is, of course, we need to look at the significance of the Nachash, or of serpents, snakes, found in other religious traditions. We should also look at the pluralism that the serpent is given within the biblical corpus itself.
We know that at least later on, Moses is given the opportunity to carry a staff intertwined by a snake. That's the earliest Asclepius symbol that we now associate with healing. The snakes are emblematic, symbolic of human healing. So it has a positive connotation, not just a negative connotation, even within the biblical corpus. So a more sophisticated scholarly enterprise here would be to compare what was going on with snakes in nearby neighboring ancient religious communities of the Near East. And that would certainly help situate the biblical material. I think that there's also traditions in other religious traditions that you and I have spoken about.
You were speaking about this before your presentation, the tradition of the Naga in many South Asian religions, Hinduism in particular, as well as Jainism. The Naga refers to the snake, very often the king cobra, but the snake in general. The Naga is associated with many mystical properties. The god of destruction, Shiva, is always accompanied by a snake. For those of you who don't know, Nagini, Voldemort's companion from the Harry Potter book series, of course. The name is derived from the feminine form of the Naga, although I think there are certain satanic overtones, unfortunately, that Nagini takes on, which are not there in the Hindu tradition. So just to add, I think what's more interesting about an approach like this is rather than trying to work towards some kind of secular framework and thereby kind of endorsing a kind of a modern Western humanism against the supposed backwardness of religious thinking. What I like about this reading and thinking about animal figures in religious thought is exposing secularism itself as a kind of humanism. And so what I think is much more interesting is actually to look at the different religious traditions and to see the very complicated relationship that humans have with non-human animals in all of these different religious traditions. I don't think we could say that the Judeo-Christian tradition in general is anti-animal or is humanist, whereas Eastern traditions are somehow more open. So I think a close reading of these religious traditions is much more interesting to me than kind of coming up with some kind of, you know, secular, non-denominational take on the human-animal relationship.
Yes, I was just a, kind of an aside. I wonder if the Nakash is sort of an ancient memory of like the Neanderthals and the apes when we used to sort of consort with them. But anyway, I don't know. I just kind of came to mind when you were saying that. But really my question is, maybe I missed this connection, but would this story that you told, you said it was to justify our extremism, that humans tend to be extreme. Were you trying to make a relationship there, how the story sort of, you know, kind of justified our extremism?
I was trying to provide some sort of segue between Carl's wonderful presentation and this one. But also, our extreme, we are, the previous conversation was talking about many of our global patterns, population growth, production and consumption of food, our broader relationships with existing human species. Those have come about in ways that needed justifications. We had to tell ourselves stories to allow ourselves to create such institutions, such mechanisms, such ways of treating animals, such ways of eating animals, ways and whys of eating animals. And we are storytelling creatures. And so that's why it's important for us to really critically examine the stories we tell and retell and the way that we interpret those stories. This biblical story has been known for thousands of years, at least 3,000 years. And it has, for better and for worse, shaped the ways that we think of ourselves in this world. And we all know the familiar ways that it has been interpreted. It's evidence of a fall, of some sort of inerrant disobedience, of willful arrogance and sin that is found within Homo sapiens. That's one way to read that story, but that's not what the story is actually about. if you actually read it differently. And so what I'm suggesting is that instead of reading it in only one way or another, that perhaps we can broaden the ways that we read out the stories that have been bequeathed to us so that we can unlearn the extremism that those certain ways of reading that have engendered. So it gets back to the theopolitical solutions that Sean asked and that was discussed in the previous session as well.
I'm looking also for a connection between the two presentations from this morning, perhaps reaching, but I want to focus on the concept of dominion. Because it seems to me if you look at the creation myth and you say humans have dominion over the earth to subdue it and control it and contain it, the sixth mass extinction event might look like a logical end from that enterprise. But if you re-examine the concept of dominion, as some animal rights activists who are working in the Judaic tradition are doing, to construct a narrative of stewardship, the sixth mass extinction event is ghastly and illogical and, you know, obviously must be slowed and stopped. So I would invite some comment on the concept of dominion that I think we've been touching on.
Absolutely. So that is a conversation about the word v'chiv shuha, which is found in Genesis chapter 1, verse 29, I think, or 30, where it talks about procreate and over the animals of the land and the birds of the sky and the fish of the sea, you shall have v'chiv shuha, whatever the heck that means. Kabash, chet bet shin. Etymologically, I don't know, but it might have also relationship with kibosh. To put a kibosh on something is to stop it, to suppress it. Interesting. Anyway, but v'chiv shuha has for thousands of years been translated and interpreted as to have mastery over, some sort of power over the natural world. And again, I think that what we need to do is embrace the other connotations that that word has, which is the dominion and the stewardship notions, the more caring features that are found within the connotations of that word. So that's one way to take a look at that conversation, how it's played out in recent times. Another way is to say, why are we privileging the first creation story? There are two creation stories. And in fact, if you look at the biblical text, there are at least three creation stories. The Noahide Chronicles is also about the recreation of the world. It's created anew. So there are at least three creation stories found. But why are we privileging only one? You have to answer that question. And if you're unwilling to answer it, then why can't we privilege story number two, which offers a much more robust, rich, organic story for us? At least in creation number two, the human being has organic materiality in his body. He's created from the dust of the earth plus Ruach Elohim, some sort of divine breath. Whereas the human beings created in creation number one are created Betzelem Elohim, in the image of God. Excuse me, can any of you show me God's initial image? God is incorporeal. Doesn't have a body. God is purely ethereal, outside of this world. And so to privilege an inorganic notion of human ontology and to rest all of our civilization on that one story, I think does us a disservice. It doesn't embrace our biological experience of actually being embodied creatures. And death, by the way, exists only in the second creation story. It doesn't exist in the first. As we talked about, death is coming for us. I know no one who's escaped life alive. And so, therefore, creation number one doesn't speak about me or to me. Creation two speaks about me. I'm material. I have breath. And I'm going to die. So I'm going to pay more attention to creation two than I am to creation one. So that might be another way for those of us who are concerned about environmentalism to say, let's leave creation one alone and pay more attention to creation two.
One thing that I'm hearing, something else that I was hearing in that that may not be about animals, but with the creation two story, it says that about homosexuality and gayness, that there may be something, therefore, in the Bible that says there is a connection, therefore, not just binary male-female, but other things as well, not necessarily bestiality, but the homosexual gay lifestyle would have biblical significance, where the current interpretation does not have that.
Again, that's one reason why I personally think there's greater richness found in this second creation story than in the first. The whole notion of relationality, of being in relationship, is found in the second creation story. The first creation story is very much worried about numbers, procreation. And you need to have energy to procreate. So the blessing, be fruitful and multiply, is followed immediately by, and to have the energy to do this, you are permitted to eat such and such things. Happens to be, again, a fruitarian diet. But in creation two, it's not the fixation of this biblical author is not so much about procreation, but about what it means to relate. How do you have a meaningful relationship with your companion, whether it's a nachash or an isha? The biblical author wrestles with what it means to be in relationship. And that's what this story seems to be about. Procreation, that comes later. But let's worry about what it means to relate.
Thank you. So you've mentioned unlearning a couple times. And my comments, I'm just formulating this out loud, and it also refers to the keynote speaker. So last night, a couple people asked me what conference I was here for. I said, humans and other animals. Well, that shut down that conversation. So I'm interested in questions of how. How do we turn around this vast, violent culture that commodifies life and all the earth? Empathy. So it's traditionally thought of, as I think of it, as transitory identification. There's something the same about me and the other. So we're not getting too far with that, as the numbers show. What about cultivating an empathy of difference? Now, there's a real losing idea, I'm sure. But the people who just their eyes turned downward when I responded last night, I'm thinking that we live in such a consumer culture that there's such alienation, by and large, from the natural world. Our minds have been colonized by commodification. So what can we do to cultivate an appreciation when there's not this relationship, when it's been so suppressed? So I think there's this oscillating paradox of empathy, empathy with sameness, empathy with difference. Any response will be appreciated.
I suppose this is what I was getting at in my question to you about the difference between companionship and friendship. Because it seems to me that even when you aren't friends, even when you can't identify with a particular non-human animal, that doesn't mean that you're not companions. That doesn't mean that you still share an ecosystem, that you share the world. And so it seems to me that this notion of, perhaps this is what you're getting at with difference and what you were trying to get at with otherness and alterity. It's obviously very strategic in some forms of discourse in order to point out the similarities between humans and other forms of non-human animals in order to secure their rights, in order to secure specific protections. Much animal welfare discourse is based on this kind of identification with the other animal. But of course, there are limits to this kind of discourse. Because when we think about difference more radically in terms of those non-human animals who we don't identify with, the snake, right, fish, insect, right? Vegetarians always say, oh, I'm vegetarian, but I eat fish. Well, you know, what does that mean? It's this idea that you can't identify with fish even as an animal. Beyond the animal world, right, to other plants, vegetal life, and even beyond the living, right? How do we think about our companionship with rivers, with mountains? They aren't alive in any strict biological sense. So I think there is something about alterity, otherness, difference, that it seems to me the concept of the companion opens itself up to. Because again, companionship, you don't have to like your companion.
No, you don't. And I think that it also, I like the word that you use, cultivate. Because cultivation is found throughout Genesis chapter 2. The primordial garden was built specifically for cultivation. The human being was placed in it to till and tend and steward it. And God commands, vayitzav, the human being to till and tend it. It's about cultivation. Cultivation also is etymologically related to culture. That to cultivate is to enculture the land and your relationship with it and to civilize yourself with it. So there's something rich going on in Genesis chapter 2 that talks about you need to literally get your hands in the dirt of life in order to appreciate your embeddedness in this perhaps not friendly relationships, but your companion, your embeddedness in networks of companionship with other species, other animals, other flora, fauna, and larger ecosystems. So again, this is why I personally love studying chapter 2 and 3 of Genesis more than I love Genesis chapter 1. There's just so much there about life. I'm a bioethicist. Life. Then I am interested in the antiseptic world of Genesis chapter 1.
So I know we've just got, I think, 2 minutes left before lunch. So last question, perhaps, is just for the average one of us here who maybe works in the trenches of the animal protection movement and talks to friends and family who have perhaps a strong biblical background, as a lot of people in this region do, just generally, what would be your kind of elevator pitch, as it were, of what this story is telling us about our relationship to all the other animals today and how the people might apply it?
It could have been otherwise, and it could be otherwise. The choice is ours. How we read this text, how we interpret this text, how we operationalize this text, and manifest it in our home life, in our communities, in our companies, companion companies, in our cities, regions, countries. It's our choice. We are not passive agents in shaping our relationships with the more than human world. We are active agents if we choose to be. We are also storying creatures. We were brought into a narrative that preceded our emergence on this world, and we are going to depart individually, maybe collectively, from this world, and stories will continue to unfold. It is the fiction of life that is the unfolding of our relationships. That's what makes it interesting. That's where the beauty is. And so that's what I would suggest, is that we need not be trapped by the ways that we have been told to think of ourselves in relationships with other creatures or with ourselves.